All right, welcome to Political Party with Adam Smith. We've got a great guest. We've got Ryan Tyson, Republican strategist, one of the best and most prominent respected in Florida from the Tyson Group. Thanks for being here.
Absolutely. Good morning, Adam. Privileged to be here.
Yeah, so we're doing this, but by the time this airs, Trump will probably have already had a big rally in Sanford. Give us the lay of the land. Let's just set the ground here that the Real Clear Politics, I think, suggests that Trump is averaging by like 3 points, 3 point something points.
Are you saying down? I haven't seen the average. What is it saying?
Yeah, he's up. I'm sorry, Biden is up, I think, 3.7. I looked this morning.
That sounds about right. So this is how I would say the lay of the land is in Florida. And I think any of my colleagues on the left would probably have to agree. It's typical Florida. We're looking at a race that's going to be somewhere between half a point to a point and a half. I'd say on the upper end would probably be a reality. I think that you definitely are seeing an overperformance of Hispanics in Florida for Donald Trump, definitely compared to 2016. I think in 2016, it was like rock bottom for the Republicans. The midterm actually got a little bit better. But definitely, as we move into this presidential, those numbers are quite different.
Across the board, like Cuban Hispanics and Puerto Ricans?
Yeah, independent Hispanics too. Absolutely. Independent Hispanics. I would say it this way. I feel like that probably the biggest movement that I've seen is the biggest difference when you compare back to Clinton, definitely when you compare back to Obama in 12. It's the failure of the Biden ticket to connect with those key segments of the Hispanic electorate. So yes, you know, the president is overperforming with Hispanics, but I think the bigger movement is that failure to connect.
We've talked about this before, the white vote. A lot of times the journalists, et cetera, love to slice and dice the electorate in Florida, and we fixate on the Hispanic vote, which of course is critical. Everything is critical in Florida. But the white vote has been really what's killing Democrats for quite a while. I'm looking at the polls and I see of those that have crosstabs, Biden's getting typically around 38 or so percent. How that's the ceiling, but at least according to the exit polls, Clinton got 32-33%.
Yeah, well, those remember, first of all, exit polls are really skewed. I mean, only 32% of the vote comes by election day in Florida. And in 2016, it was, I think Trump won the state by like 13 points on election day, if I remember correctly. I mean, it's very skewed. You have to be really careful about the white vote on that segment of on exit polls on election day. I would tell you that I feel like in my business, I've seen a ceiling that Democrats have been hitting with white voters overall in Florida that have dated back for the last three statewide elections. 38% seems to be the sweet spot. If Joe Biden can get to 40% of the actual share of the white vote that turns out, that's a winning, you know, that's winning math for him. But it hasn't happened in a really long time in Florida. No Democrat's gotten close to that long time.
Now, what I will say is what I've seen in those crosstabs, and these are public polls, often not quite as reliable as the polling you do. I've seen the white vote where Trump was winning it by 30 points. Now he's winning it by 15, 14 points.
Well, good point there. He is, but I would offer to you one of the biggest reasons that movement has occurred is its refusals. It's whites that are refusing to give an answer on the ballot. I think that's what I've seen in my data, and I've just wrapped up surveys in Arizona, Michigan, Pennsylvania, and Wisconsin. And there is something similar happening in all of those states. It's happening here as well. And it's a disproportionate number of white voters that are refusing to answer the ballot question. Maybe a lot of other pollsters aren't seeing that. I know that we're seeing it, and it's almost like the moment you put Donald Trump's name into a survey, there is a disproportionate share of a segment of the white electorate that just checks out. We're not talking to you, or we're going to refuse to answer your ballot question.
And I think that's because they assume it's, you know, they're going to be called racist, they're going to be called idiots, they're going to be called...
That's how I interpret it, but there's a lot of different reasons for it. I mean, I will say, you know, especially from the part of the state that I'm from, Levy County, which is in the Gainesville market, the northern Gulf Coast, you know, we have for a long time felt that it's that way, you know, and I think that there's a lot of suburban rural areas of the state where Trump supporters feel like if they identify themselves as such, that's how they're labeled, and they don't trust pollsters, they see the polls in the news, they don't trust, you know, strangers on the phone, that sort of thing.
So to extrapolate, there's a lot of buzz now about, is there a national landslide coming? Is there a brutal, is Trump just going to get shellacked?
No. No. So I think what's interesting is if you date back to 2012, you know, the President Obama won the Electoral College outright, but there were really tight margins in a lot of those states. That was 16 as well. Very tight margins in all of the states that ended up becoming an effective landslide for the president in the Electoral College. I would offer that that's how I see it today. I do believe that it'll be that close in every single one of those states. And I do believe that it's quite possible that 330, you know, 315 or whatever is possible. But I think it's going to break one way. You know, it's either going to go one of the two ways. I mean, I'm fairly optimistic for my side right now, based on what it is that I'm seeing. I would offer this.
You're optimistic that Trump will be winning a second term.
That's correct.
Wow.
That's correct. And I say that for this reason. I'm not yet convinced that Joe Biden can earn the turnout that he needs to defeat the turnout that Donald Trump will receive. And I want to be very clear what I'm saying. Nobody denies, we know that the left hates Donald Trump. I get it. But does the left connect? Do the key segments of the Democrat electorate that elected Barack Obama two times, do those voters connect to Joe Biden and Kamala Harris? I think we're going to know soon. We don't know right now. I would say a lot of my data raises questions to that effect. And I would also say, I think a lot of my colleagues on the left have acknowledged that by the way that they've moved money into this state, where they're moving money into this state, and how. To me, this entire election hinges on that question. Can Joe Biden himself inspire the ascending electorate to turn out and vote for him in a way that they did for Barack Obama, particularly in 2012? Furthermore, in Florida, like, for example, do we see African-American turnout continue to wane as we have in each presidential election dating back to 2008? These are all questions in my mind that no one knows the answer to. I'm sure my colleagues on the left are working their ground games and whatnot to try to anticipate, you know, the kind of things they need to do to win. But to me, those are the things that polls cannot pick up. You put together all of these different elements, and it's why I think you see these lopsided surveys that even I myself have produced, you know, confidentially in our shop.
Hate of Trump is not a sufficient motivator, particularly for that ascendant electorate. And by that, you're talking about young voters.
Yes. I will say this too. And I have seen in my data time and time again, and this is another data point that I find fascinating when you do a thoughtful analysis of your data, right? Voters under 40. The margins between Trump and Biden are nowhere near what they were whenever Trump was running against Hillary Clinton. They're tighter. I'm not suggesting that the president's going to win these voters, but I'm saying the margins are tighter. And I think that you have to stop for a second and you have to think about it. To defeat an incumbent president, regardless of pandemics or anything else, that's a tall order. It's hard to do. And if you're going to do it, you have to ask yourself this question, is hate enough alone? I don't know that it is, especially when you juxtapose that on the right, when they hate the left just as much, with just as much passion and fervor, but they also love their candidate. That's why I think, you know, this election, I hate this to make it generic and say, oh, it's all about turnout. But realistically, especially in the era of COVID and whatnot, you have to ask yourself that question. You know, which base is most inspired by what's being sold? And I would say at this point that there's a slight advantage on the right based off everything that I see. And that's everywhere. That's not just in Florida. I think that's all over.
There's some national polls, and the national polls have their fault, but you can usually, we're looking at national polls, and they're now consistently double-digit Biden lead. You think that's probably bunk? Or,
well, no, I don't know. I wouldn't say that that's bunk. I mean, I'm a true believer that the data set says what it says, right? First of all, no one knows what the true partisan makeup of a national survey sample should be. And too many states don't even have party registration. So I would say you never really know. You can only balance a national survey, geographically speaking, and by gender, race, that sort of thing. But I would say those national surveys, is Biden leading by double digits with 59-58%? Or is he leading it with like 50? I don't know. What is it? Because if it's 50, I would offer to you, yeah, that's the split country that we're looking at. And I think you see the refusal rates and the folks that are unsure that they're gonna have to decide very late. And when I say decide very late, it's the same thing we saw in 16. These are the folks that are waiting to vote till election day. They're gonna make their decision. Trump's gotta give them a case to make sure these folks turn out and collapse. And then I would also offer this too, and I think you've seen this on some Gallup data that was just made public. I'm seeing it on all of my surveys too. It doesn't matter what swing state I'm in. more people, and it's typically over a majority, it's like 52, 54, somewhere in there, they feel that they're better off now than they were 4 years ago. That's a hard order. It's a tall order to fire a president when it's that way, particularly in a re-elect year.
All right, Ryan, I was giving you some grief before we started recording this because I was a reporter in 2016, and I distinctly remember having conversations with you where you sounded absolutely sure, not happy about it, but absolutely sure that Trump was going to lose Florida.
Yeah, I will tell you that I didn't know how to read data back then as well, or maybe the way I should say it is that Donald Trump has taught us how to better interpret data. And I will say that, you know, I would look at the ballot top line, which I think a lot of people are doing right now. And I never really dove into the internals of the crosstabs to see what was possible with the turnout model. And I'll be blunt to say, I was a part of that sea of people. But when I went back and looked at my data at the very end, it tells a story, especially when we saw what happened. And you go into the precinct analysis in Florida as to who turned out on election day and how they did it, and how they gave him his win. The data absolutely allowed for that to be possible. Obviously we still had those, you know, the missing Trump voters that weren't in surveys, things of that nature. With that said, you know, as I was telling you earlier, when you're a pollster in the era of Donald Trump and being a pollster with him on the ballot more specifically, you get all kinds of weird things that happen. You get a disproportionate share of white voters that hang the phone up or they don't even want to talk to you. I will tell you what's interesting is that same hesitance doesn't exist this year with Hispanics at all. There's actually the exact opposite. We don't see that at all, but it is something that we do see with white voters. I'm not going to sit here and try to spin and say that, you know, there's nothing to be worried about with the white electorate or with I-4 voters. I do think that things are definitely looking better for Biden along I-4 than his predecessor, you know, Hillary Clinton had. But with that said, I would tell you lessons learned when you are doing polling in the era of Donald Trump. Don't focus on the top line. Do a thoughtful analysis of the internals. Understand the turnout metrics that are and models that are occurring in these states, and do a better job of conducting thoughtful analysis on your own data. Because if you stick to the top line, you're probably going to get embarrassed.
Problem is in Florida. You know, I look at these. I try to when I can get the crosstabs. I look at them, and it's okay. Trump's doing better with Hispanics, but Biden's doing better with white people or more white people. Biden's doing better with seniors. What are you seeing with seniors, by the way?
Actually, I'm not seeing he's doing slightly better with seniors. But when we looked at our benchmarks and what vote goals are for Republicans, and we looked back at 2016, and I don't really see that problem's as bad as has been made out to be, not in my own data, at least.
Well, before we let you go, give us some background on you. How'd you get, you're from Levy County. How'd you get to be where you are in politics?
Well, an old country sheriff named Charlie Dean let me work for him in the state house. And then I ended up working for him in the Senate. And to be quite honest with you, it's a very unconventional way that I got into what I do today. I've never been in any of the power circles of the Republican Party or the candidates or anything like that. I would just say some good old fashioned hard work. And I think that comes from the part of the world that I'm from. I mean, I'd like to think that it's a different way that we conduct data, different way that we analyze data. And it's all because we're not from the Beltway. We're not from a big city. We try to connect with the people. The way we do our market research, our focus groups, they're all very grassroots and from the ground. So I would say that, you know, It's I don't want to bore your viewers today with the details, but it was a very unconventional way that the business started, and I think that's why we've been successful is because we were born in a way that most didn't come into this business, if that makes sense.
What state worries you the most as a Republican? What state worries you the most, or states?
Pennsylvania, yeah, suburbs of Philadelphia. You know, I'd say Pennsylvania. I feel like, you know, a lot of the other dynamics that I'm tracking in some of these other states, I feel that they're very, very close. I mean, don't get me wrong. When we talk about Michigan and Wisconsin, the margins are as close as they were last time. And it may be slightly favoring the other side, but the margins are that tight. And I would say that all of those Rust Belt states worry me. But being blunt, as a Republican, I look at all of these swing states and I realize that if you do not have the blocking and tackling of campaigns together, if you do not have that fundamental vote goal strategy, building your math to win in all of these states, and you are actually projecting your own electorate to vote, you'll lose. I just believe
that you, like Arizona, you're polling in, Michigan, Wisconsin, It's not in front of me, but I feel like I've seen polling that shows comfortable, virtually insurmountable, nothing's insurmountable, but very comfortable leads for Biden.
I think they're disconnected from the turnout model. That's all. And I would say that, again, you know, you have to put yourself into the actual, you know, who has got the best ground game that's actually turning out their supporters. And notice how I just couched that. Let me give it to you this way. 2012 was an excellent election to sit back and be a student of the game, right? You had an incumbent president who had a data-driven operation that turned out voters. They started with registration, they turned out voters. And the other side was predominantly on TV with persuasion. That's pretty much a, you know, the Reader's Digest version, if you would, of what was happening in 2012. Fast forward to today, and I think there's a lot of eerie similarities between the two. It's a reelect year. You've got a president that is very, they're largely working off of ground game. I mean, you've seen the voter registration advantage. That's what we used to see in the era of Obama. We're now seeing that being deployed in the era of Trump. I think they're going to probably have, the Republicans are only going to be down about 145,000 to the Democrats when the books close on this. That's historically close. It's never been that close in the history of the state. But furthermore, you look at the ground, you look at the grassroots activity, you look at the passion that you see on the ground with Trump supporters, and it reminds you a lot of what the president used to have with his, President Obama used to have with his supporters. Juxtapose that with the challenger that's predominantly on TV with all of this persuasion. And I feel like there's a lot of weird similarities, except the roles are flipped. The parties are flipped.
That's very true.
And with that said, that's why I say advantage, as I look at the data, advantage still goes to the side that actually has something to turn out for, not just against.
Well, thank you for coming on and scaring the shit out of Democrats. We have been getting a little cocky with the national press. You are a pro. And the other bad news for Democrats is this is not a guy who really spins. He's not a spin meister who just says what he wants, you know, what his party wants you to say. He's basing it on what he's actually seeing. And that bums me out. Anyway, thank you, Brian. I really appreciate it. You're
absolutely, Adam. Anytime. Take care, brother.
Right. Take care, man.